Yeah, thank you, Damani.
Thank you.
So, we are just Marcel and Max. This is our talk, how we sailed into production, about our journey with GitOps in Deutsche Telekom.
Yeah, and I think if you want to have more technical insights of what we are doing and want to see some more of depth into what we put into our slides, please go to the GitHub page. There's much more information than we can pack into this talk here. And I'm Marcel. So Max, I think we can start.
Yes. So who are we? Next slide, Marcel. Who are we? What do we do? And what is our operational goal? So we are a small team within DT. Roughly 10 people. We are just two of the people in that team. Brooke, who will speak after us, is actually our squad lead, so technically our technical head. We are here to provide Kubernetes to our organization. Our organization is complicated, Marcel. We have a lot of different environments that we target. Like, we have data centers, we have edge locations, and we have things that you probably don't even think about as edge, that are far edge locations, where we have hundreds to thousands of them all over Germany. Our main goal is to be bare metal focused for all that deployments, because that gives us less overhead, uncomplicated multi-tenancy, because we don't need to care about hypervisors. And it gives us the opportunity to use hardware acceleration for our network functions. Because as we are a telco, we mostly have network technology on there. So from things that you interact with, like voice platforms, your normal mobile phone, to even TV, mobile edge sites, LTE, basically everything that you you get as a service from a telco or from our telco goes over platforms that we will have on our platform in the future. For our internal customers, we provide managed clusters, so we don't leave them alone. We just want them to bring their own application. Everything else is managed by us. That includes identity and access management. So we provide them with a way to get their credentials into the cluster, to onboard their external CA if they have that. But more importantly, we basically do all the lifecycle stuff for them. We care about versions of version upgrades. We care about providing monitoring and logging. So they just need to bring their application, know their application, and get that up and running.
Yeah, for that, we introduced a lot of repositories. One of them is holding only the definitions. So everything which resides inside cluster API is defined in definitions. So how does the cluster look like? How many CPUs, RAM, and also how much storage is provided? That's all resides in definitions. Then we have a dedicated repository for global policies we apply for all of our customers, which reside in a dedicated repository to easier work on them and lifecycle them. And then we have a more complicated repository where I go next into. And then we have this structure we have in the components repository, also for all the clusters of our customers. So each customer gets a repository in that structure to also manage stack anomalies. So everything which a customer needs, which needs root access or specific writes or a specific software which needs to be reviewed by us, is put into customer components. And that's also handled our onboarding in a GitOps way, so they onboard themselves via a pull request. All of those repositories are then synced into our clusters. And yeah, then we come to the next interesting part. How do we manage our components? And yeah, shipping our components to the cluster. And we started with repo layouts for those because they have a lot of different configurations. They differ between environments, they differ between sites, they differ between different networks, and so on. I used the environment, the environment tag we have for easier understanding. We have that with a lot of other things, but I think the environment is really easy to understand. So we thought of, we have a branch per environment, or we could use tags per environment, or we have different repos per environment. That's the right thing. But all of that was not really a good way for us and complicated the management more than it solves it for us. So we go then with another approach, which was a single repo with one branch and then folders to specify different configurations. So those environments I showed you in the slide before are located in the environments folder. And then we have different customizations in Flux, which apply only that path of that directory structure into the cluster. And one change can then change either a test environment, a refer environment, production environment, but also can change other things like site specifics or so on. And also this one repository has a lot of customizations. So I think more than 10 are currently used to only apply that one repo. And then we had some other pitfalls. We used Helm in the beginning, and then we got the issue that if you upgrade a component via Helm, it normally does not upgrade the CRD. So if a CRD gets patched and has some new functionality, it was not used inside the cluster because Helm decides to not manage CRDs, only install them, and if they exist, it does not do anything about it. So this leads to issues because customers then said, hey, you installed this new version, but that feature is not working. And then we had components which were upgraded, but don't have their full potential because of CRDs missing. And this got fixed inside Flux. So it's now possible and it's not an issue anymore for us, but still in Helm, this issue persists. So if you use Helm CLI, you have still that issue. Okay. And then we come to GitOps as a service and what we do there.
Yeah, we personally use GitOps and we're a great fan of that. But we also wanted to make it as easy for our tenants or internal customers to use it as well. So we basically done all the heavy lifting for them once they get access to their cluster already. So every cluster that we ship or give hand over to a tenant directly has Zops integration for secret management in a Git native way. All the repositories that you need to directly just put your applications in Git and have them rolled out into your cluster are there. All Flux components are there and pre-configured. We update them as we do everything else. We generally aim just to make it the path of least resistance. So the easiest thing for you to do as a customer is also to use GitOps. We're not forcing you to, but we think that if we make it as easy as possible for you, it's worth the initial time that you need to invest to actually get into GitOps when you come from other tools. And do it as well. For that, we are heavily relying on operators. So everything from Grafana, RBAC manager to actually have a multi-tenancy capable cluster with the current iteration of RBAC, Kivano to actually lock that down so that tenants can't break our clusters while still having the necessary rights to roll out their application, because RBAC isn't as granular as we wanted to be in some cases. Obviously Flux and Prometheus. We also declare our clusters in a declarative way. As Marcel mentioned earlier, we are using cluster API in the background. Initially, we went for an approach of writing basically a Helm chart that defined a cluster and using that Helm chart to generate the necessary resources to define a cluster and lifecycle that. But we walked away from that idea for one important reason. Helm isn't a state machine and cluster API still needs some state. It doesn't fully abstract that away yet. That might come in the future, but right now, if you just do a version upgrade and your Helm chart isn't sophisticated enough, you will break your cluster, because you can generate stuff that will break your cluster and cluster API will try to reconcile that. But the version upgrade of workers before masters, for example, is possible, even though it will break your cluster. For that reason, we actually went a step backward and are just using plain manifests in Git per cluster with a predetermined file name, so we can easily automatically touch them via tooling. But in general, we don't use Helm anymore for that components. We're just using them as plain manifests and upgrading them via additional tooling. For the future, we are looking to moving that all into an operator, so that that part becomes that complicated part of the lifecycle becomes abstracted away. But currently, that wasn't possible for us with the existing tooling, so we needed to take a step back and reevaluate our options. Also, we have a few lessons that we learned during the 1.5 years that we actually have customers on our platform. One important part was it really makes no sense to try to hide things away from the customer. They just come and ask you for the exact details that you hid away in a different repo. If your question gets asked more than twice, you should probably have better documentation that you currently have, because for people that are not used to GitOps, the initial concept is a bit complicated, and they still they need some time to onboard. And the other part is, you really need to enforce and force your customers to actually comply with rules, because once they basically start, even if you write rules, if you don't enforce them, they might as well not be there at all, because once customers start working around those rules or working as they were not there, it's really hard to get them off that again. And that makes your life as a platform operator quite hard. And also, it's always DNS. So a lot of complicated network debugging things that we had were rooted in DNS. But I guess that's also just a running joke by this time.
Yeah, and then we come to our end and where we want to go with our platform. I think in the beginning, we started with Helm, which was a good approach to roll out clusters in the beginning. It was an easy tool. Most of us understood it, but we still found the limits of it. And now we are working together also with Upstream to find a better way. And I think we will start in the next months developing our own. Unless there is some more tooling available in the Upstream, which we also work on. But for all our internal stuff, there will come a lot of applications which need to be written to get that up and running. I think, Max, you have also some more. Yeah.
The other part is what I said earlier about giving tenants more insight. We are planning to restructure our Git repositories a bit so that we move basically everything that is just cluster dependent into the repositories that are seen and can be influenced by our customers and just keep the stuff that is really common across all clusters, like the Flux version we roll out, the Vim versions of monitoring that we roll out, and all non-cluster specific settings in one central repo, and have everything else decentralized, where one customer can basically see all the special configuration of his cluster in one place. Because that is one thing that we noticed. We also want to go more into the path of validation. We're currently not validating what is actually in cluster besides what Flux does. There are tools from WeFox and from others out there that validate what is running in your cluster to what is in Git, in addition to what Flux does, so that nothing that is not in Git can run. We're really looking forward to roll that out, but we haven't yet. And we need to tighter couple other systems into our stack management, like writing operators for integrating IPAM and all other network related things that we currently control outside of Kubernetes. Yeah, if you want to delve into the technical details, you can do so on our GitHub. We've published a rather detailed write-up of our current layout there, and we're going to update that once we migrated to the newer layout. We are also open for questions on there. So if you have anything you want to know, just shoot us an issue, a question, or whatever you feel like is a good idea.